In Crystal Palace, each player represents a nation at the first World's Fair in 1851 in London. To make sure that your country truly attracts everyone's attention, you're going to showcase spectacular inventions and recruit the brightest, most influential minds of your time, all to promote your homeland. Whether in the sacred halls of Westminster or in the dark corners of the docks, you're pulling strings everywhere to prepare for the great event in the best possible way. And it could all be so easy if your government, you know, had provided you with unlimited means. As it is, you are constantly torn between modest investments and excessive loans. Excessive loans. But if you make the right choices for the great exhibition, your nation will be covered in glory at Crystal Palace. All right. So what are you guys looking at here? Well, you're looking at a whole bunch of individual boards, as you can see. There are 8 location boards. The location boards have the numbers in the top-hand corner. So we have the Patent Office, the British Museum, the Bank of England, Westminster. We have the Reform Club, London Times, the Port of London, and finally, Waterloo Station. These all have worker placement locations for our dice. Our dice are going to be used as workers out here on those boards. Then there is the administrative board or the administration board. There is a victory point track around the outside, around the outside, around the outside. There is a buzz or promotion or advertising track here that takes up the majority of these spaces in here. There are 2 markers per player on these to signify a couple of these milestones that we may be reaching as the game goes along. There are flyers, which are one-time bonuses as you acquire or as you reach those spaces. Then there is the income track over on the right-hand side of that. Then down below here, we have the black market, in which we're going to be getting additional income throughout the game. And then on each board, there are various little things out here on the various boards. So on the patent board, or the patent office, we have patent or also prototype cards. One side, when they're face up, these are patents. When they're on the other side, they are prototypes. Then on the Reform Club, these are character cards here. There are shares. Now, I hesitate to use the term share, even though that's what they're called in the game. These are just one-time bonuses. Don't think investment shares or anything like that here in the Bank of England. Then there are publisher tiles and research tiles. The research tiles are here. The publisher tiles are these guys out there. Then we have loans. Now the loans are actually off board. They may come in handy, or they're definitely going to come in handy. They may be used to access as our game goes along. And there are various other little markers out here. Then off board, if you will, we have the bank. Now the bank, we're using poker chips because honestly it's just cardboard money, generic money that came with the prototype, so we decided to use poker chips. Then, as the aforementioned loans, we have gears. Now these, I believe, will be some sort of either cardboard or wooden or maybe metal gear shaped gears here. Then we have energy tokens, which are represented by light bulbs in the game. Then we have the pocket watch. The pocket watch is a double-sided little bonus that players may be able to acquire. Then in our tableaus here, we have asymmetric player boards, and these represent different countries attending the World's Fair. As you can see, I chose to play Turkey. We have the flag in the top left corner, and then the only asymmetric aspect of the player boards is the objective track. So basically where one of your administrators or your meeples, not a worker, an administrator, important difference here, this area right through here, so whatever these little milestones or objectives are, this is the only asymmetric part of our player boards there. One assistant starts in the bottom space of that, and then there's going to be a reminder here of what it costs to pay back loans and what you get regarding loans. Loans are not necessarily to be feared. They could be only penalize you at best 3 points, at worst 10 points, or technically 8 points. Then there are research spaces that can be filled by research tiles throughout the game. As you can see, these are negative points that you can cover up as the game goes along. Then there's a certain landmark in that flag's country. Like, for instance, on Derek's, I believe he is playing Germany. I forget what the various ones are, but they're little mile landmarks that are, it's just flavor up there. Then in the right-hand side, there is the newspaper track. The newspaper track allows you to convert newspapers into these various things. Then below that is a reminder of what you can buy and sell energy and gears to and from the bank for over here. That's going to be a very, very important. And then finally, at the bottom is an exceptional player aid that does a very good job of walking you through each step of the game. Really excellent job there. Then off your player board, every player has 6 dice total. You might be asking yourself, well, I only see 4 dice. That is true. The reason for that, players have to acquire their other 2 dice or their other 2 workers throughout gameplay if they so choose to do so. Everybody has 6 assistants, one of which will stay here on this track. The other 5 will possibly be going out into the black market. Then there's a handy dandy little treasure chest. The purpose of this treasure chest is to put over your dice once you've chosen what your dice are. We'll go into that here, obviously, as the game goes along. Then up here, there are 50 and 100 point victory point markers in each player's color there. Then every player is going to start with 1 gear and 1 energy or light bulb. I'll use that term interchangeably as the game goes along. And 40 pounds British sterling, as it is, they're 40 bucks going forward. So that's everything that everybody starts with. Now you might be looking at these cards. These are going to be here for an example as we go along throughout the game. So that's everything that you guys are looking at here. However, what is it you're trying to do? Well, the goal of the game is victory points, right? Everyone starts here on the victory point track. I do want to point out that everybody starts at 5 points. Anytime you see a game that usually starts you above 0, usually indicates that you may be paying or losing victory points, which is certainly the case that you may be paying victory points as the game goes along, but minor here or there. However, the goal of the game, as I mentioned, is victory points. You're going to be getting victory points a number of ways. You're going to be getting victory points by placing your markers out onto these locations every round and being able to recoup or gain victory points through that. Going to be gaining victory points by flipping over these patent cards into prototypes. Same with these character cards. Anytime you see this little star or metal symbol, that represents victory points. You're going to be gaining victory points at the end of the game if you have acquired or moved your assistant up any of these steps here. Also, there's going to be research tiles potentially that will give you victory points, and you'll be covering up negative victory points, which by default means you're gaining victory points, right? And then finally, there's a couple more ways you're going to gain victory points, and those are based on a hierarchy on who is furthest up this track, the top 3 as you can see there. And finally, whoever is highest in the black market track here with their assistants as there. That's how you're going to be getting victory points. But how the hell do you gain those victory points now? Well, let's go over how you actually play the game. So, the game of Crystal Palace is played over 5 rounds. We have a little round marker here, and there's 2 seasons in 1849, or 2 rounds, if you will. Same with 2 in 1850, and finally 1 in 1851, when the actual World's Fair takes place. So the game takes place over 5 rounds. Each of those rounds consists of 7 phases. Now that sounds like a lot, and it kind of is. However, again, this player aid at the bottom does an amazing job of walking you through and breaking down each of the 7 phases, and that's actually how I'm going to go about teaching the game. So each round consists of deciding on the value of your dice and paying for your dice, then placing your dice, then taking the actual actions in numerical order of the locations, 1 through 8, and then paying the salary and any character abilities for characters that you may have, then potentially converting patents into prototypes, so flipping these over, then gaining income, and then preparing for the next round. So those are the 7 steps in Crystal Palace. Now, let's go ahead and break down each of those steps. So, step 1, Everyone has four workers, which are your four dice. Unlike a lot of games in which you have workers as dice, you either normally, like in a Teotihuacan, you started at one and they kind of mature up into more powerful dice. Other games, you'll roll these. Neither of these are in play here. Instead, you choose. You want all sixes? Hey, go for it. You want all ones? Go for it. The catch, though, is that second part of phase one, and that is you have to pay for every pip. £1 per pip. So, as it is, as you can see here, a 4, 3, 2, and 1 is going to cost me £10. In other words, I would have to pay $10. There we go. Now, once I have chosen and I set my dice to whatever value that is, let's say I do, I don't know, something along the lines of that. Once you do so, you're going to cover it like that, and then everybody will reveal all at once. Okay? Then, when we reveal, whoever has the highest pip value, i.e. whoever has paid the most, will become the first player. If tied, you're going to evaluate highest pip value die versus highest pip value die of those tied. So for instance, let's say Shrey and I both had paid a total of 12 as the high player, or we had paid the most, and maybe he did 4, 4, 3, 1. In that case, I have a 5, which is the highest pip value, I would be first. If it had gone 4, 4, 2, 1 versus 4, 4, bad example. You get the idea. We would compare first die, then second die, until we break the tie based on whoever has the highest pip value in that. Okay, they would become the first player. Then it's clockwise in order from there. Then whoever had paid the least or the fewest is going to bump up their newspaper track one as kind of a consolation prize for being the chintziest that round. All right? The second phase is when we're actually going to place our workers. And now I'm going to actually switch over to explain all of the locations out here on the board. Now, just like in a game like Dominant Species or similar, we're going to take turns all placing one worker at a time, going clockwise around the table until we have all placed all of our dice. Once we have placed all of our dice, we'll go into the next phase, which then resolves those dice. So remember, all of us placing one at a time, then we resolve. So that said, let's go over the 8 locations. So I'm going to briefly go over the first one, and then we're going to kind of double back onto that. The first one is the patent office. So Derek, if you can point to the worker placement places at the very top of that, you'll notice, and this is based on player count. So the reason these are individual boards like this is because some of these break down, like this board is a 4-player, on the backside is the 3-player, and then there's another board that is the 2 and the 3-player. So it's completely modular for that reason. This being a 4-player game, and it does go up to 5, you'll notice that there are 5 worker placement locations at the top of the board up there. Those numbers, the pips as you see on that die, represent the minimum value of die that you can place on that location. So for instance, the far left space over there, the smallest value die that you can place on there is a 4. So placing a 4 out there is legit. You can also place a 4 on any other available space on there because it's a minimum value. So if you wanted, you could place a 4 on that, like so, if you so wish to do so, to block off those spaces from your opponents. Keep that in mind. So that's how we're going to go about placing out here, and you can place onto any space provided that you abide by that rule. That is the minimum pip value that can go on that location. Notice that there are no 6s on the board, and as it is, there is actually only 1 5. The highest other values are 4, so anything on a 5 or a 6 just gives you a better chance to activate that location earlier, okay? So going around, now you're also going to notice a couple of symbols above a couple of these locations. This first one is an administrative action, and I will double back onto that. And this one is pay $2 cash. These activate immediately when you place the die onto that location. So what does that mean with the $2? You literally pay £2 to the bank to be able to place your die on that location, okay? So going around, that is the actual mechanism of that. Now I will talk about the administrative action. So anytime you see a little bust of a person on there, what that means is you have essentially one of three options. The first option is to raise your administrator that's on your objective up one based on whatever the rule is or the goal is. This says I must have four dice. Well, I have four. Good deal. So at the end of the game, I will get 1 point. If I acquire a fifth or a sixth die, respectively, I then could then choose to use my administrative action to bump that up. Now, you aren't using more workers to do that. It's simply how high did that administrator make it by the end of the game. Does that make sense?
It's not cumulative.
Correct. Right? So it's not going to be 12 if I make it to the top. It's 7 if I make it to the top. Any questions on that?
No.
That is one of your three options. Your second option, I'm going to bring your attention down here to the black market. Now, the black market is divided into a bunch of different icons. Essentially, you have a worker placement area here and then a reward during income phase here. That is essentially how this is broken down. So when you choose, when you get the administrative action, so let's say that Derek actually placed up there under the 4 spot using a 5 die, and he says, you know what, for my administrative action, I want to place one of my administrator onto the black market. To do so, you must go onto the lowest available space to go on there and then immediately pay whatever to the bank. So in this case, it shows $1. So then maybe later on, I place one of my dice and maybe I place it under that location and I say I'm going to do the same. I then would go to the lowest available space, paying $1 or $2 or $3 or $4, depending on what the lowest available space is. That is option number 2. Option number 3 is, and let's say we go around the board and now Derek goes ahead and places one of his dice out here first. There, and it's another administrative action. He could, again, bump his administrator up. He could place this one here, or he could raise one of his administrators up one step for free. So, if it just so happened that it were something along the lines of, say, this, and I'll explain to you how this could happen later on, it goes to the next available space on the board. So in this case, Derek just leapfrogs up to there, but that's free because it was over, he paid to place, not to jump. You don't do that. Then if on a subsequent turn, I take another administrative action, I could bump this one up there, or maybe I just go ahead and go right there. So those are your three options whenever you have an administrative action. So 1, raise this up. 2, place to the bottom and pay. Or 3, bump one up one space. Mm-hmm. Any questions on any of that? All right? In addition, anytime you take an administrative action, so in other words, okay, Derek goes onto there. In addition to those three options that he has, at any point, or at that point, I should say, if this little kind of vanilla looking yellow area here, this banner. So in other words, if you have a administrator here, 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 or here, not on the bottom two locations, you can choose to drop them one available space. So in other words, if Derek were to do that, he would drop to the next available. However, if it were me and I did this, I would have to drop one of these two down to there. Okay, because that's the next available space. By doing so, you get a gear, as long as there's a gear available. So, and the gear would just come on over into your supply because you're going to need gears to spend as a resource as the game goes along. Does that make sense?
Yes.
If there are no gears available, doesn't make sense to do that. However, if it just so happened, and it doesn't matter the color in this case, whoever chooses to do that, then there is no available space. Easy enough. So if Jess says, you know what, and she goes out there, she takes an administrative action, whatever it is she does, she wants to take one of these gears, she just removes it and it goes back into her supply in that case because there's no available space for her to drop. She would take one of those gears and boom, easy enough.
So that's not your administrative action?
Yeah, that is in addition, correct. Anytime you have one of your administrators in that area equal to the banner there. Does that make sense?
And you're still taking it at the time of an administrative action.
Correct. So, okay. So
yeah,
going back.
No.
And this is a good point. So let's say Jess went ahead and went like so. She then says, you know what? I'm going to take my administrative action to be able to place this here. She pays the $2 to the bank, and then she can immediately drop that off and take a gear, and there's her administrative action. Does that make sense?
Yeah, on top of it. But correct. I can't just go drop one off of there for a gear some other time.
Correct. It's only when you take that administrative action.
Okay.
So you can move it up and then move it right back.
Right, yes. Exactly. Like if it were me, I could bump that up and then choose to drop this one down. Right?
Yep, very clear.
Mix and match. Okay.
Got it.
All right. I don't want to belabor that anymore.
Good.
Okay. The other thing that I will talk about with the black market is if this ever fills, in other words, okay, it's like this. And then someone, Shrey, go and join the party. If Shrey were to place, it doesn't matter who it is, whether it's Shrey or anyone else, fills that market. At that moment, everything clears off. Every administrative, except the one that just got placed. So, be careful. We have had this happen in a two-player game, and oh, that hurts! Okay, so be aware of that. Okay? All right, so you're gonna get punted off for the example later on. So that's the administrative action. We've talked about paying money, and we've talked about the black market. When you go to the patent office, you place your dice. Same goes with any of these. Then, when we get to phase three, we're actually going to activate all of these buildings, 1 through 8. So let's go ahead and talk about when we go here. So in die order, and let me go ahead and say we're like this. There we go. Let's say they were placed like so, okay? You would think that these go ahead, the first die on there going left to right would be the white 5. However, you would be incorrect. What's the highest pip value in this case? That would be Jess's 6.
Yes.
So the 6 would activate first. It will go onto the leftmost space down below and immediately get whatever the benefit is there, which in that case is 1 newspaper. So in that case, Jess's newspaper would bump up 1. And then, hold on, she immediately takes her action. Her action is she chooses one of these available cards from the display to put into her tableau. That is it, nothing else happens. Let's say for argument's sake that she chooses this, done. Then we would go to the next highest pip value, which would be Derek's 5, newspaper. He chooses one of the available, and then it goes like so, and then yellow would choose. Now, if I choose not to take an action, because maybe I really just wanted one of those two cards, I could say, hey, just give me my die back, and I get nothing for it. However, you'll notice that there are 5 available spaces up there, and there are only 4 activation spaces there. If it were so happen, and maybe I placed a 1 here and there, so Shrey says he wants to do both of those. He chooses both those cards. Okay, easy enough. Well, I no longer can even take that action, even if I wanted to. So I say, hey, let me have my die back, but I do get a consolation prize. That consolation prize is I get 1 pound for not being able to place my die and activate it. However, you will notice I will have paid $2 to go there, and now I get a dollar consolation. However, if I chose not to take an action and I was able to, maybe Shrey only took that, and I chose not to go there, I do not get the dollar consolation. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Easy enough? All right, so we're gonna double back onto the patent office and the cards here in a little bit. Moving on now to the British Museum. I've talked about the mechanisms of how you activate dice in the whole nine yards, so we're just going to now talk about what the actual locations do. This location is you get research tiles. Now, there are essentially 2 different types of research tiles in this game, and I'll go ahead and show you these here. Universal. Players, I assume, know that a lightning bolt usually indicates immediate. So you get whatever is shown here. I get 1 newspaper, I get 1 buzz, and I get $3 cash. Whereas this one, you'll notice the income phase is step 6. This says in step 6, I get whatever that income is, which is a bump on the income track. So this will happen every phase 6. This happens 1 time immediately, and that's that. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yes.
All right. So whenever you go here, you'll notice there are 3 options. There are only 2 locations in which to go ahead and activate. Moving on to the Bank of England, you choose one of these 2. These are a 1-time bonus, similar. So what it says is easy enough. You would just acquire it, put it over here. You would get a 3 value bump onto the income track and score however many victory points as shown here. So in this case, yellow would bump up three income, one, two, three. Okay, cool. When we get to the income phase, I'll get that, but I score no points because it showed none. Whereas earlier, I will have gotten one newspaper, which we've already explained, $3 cash and buzz. Buzz is actually this track right here. And I'll cover this as we go along here in a little bit, okay? All right, so that is the Bank of England. I'm gonna put that back so I don't forget. Now, moving now here onto Westminster, you'll notice that when you go here, you get a dollar or pay $2 for the second location. You immediately move right one space and you immediately get whatever the bonus is, $2. Activate one of your income banners. I'll talk about that in a moment. Get one light bulb or one energy or get $2. If you ever go try and go past that, you'll get one energy or $2. The income one. So you'll notice that it shows a little six banner, just like on your player aid, it shows a little six banner for your income. Well, that would be anything that you have at the black market, which if I were to immediately bump up to there, I could get one newspaper, $2, a newspaper and one income bump on that track, or move that one over further. Easy enough. So that is a big green banner as shown there. In addition to that, you'll see that any of these research tiles may have that, and you immediately could trigger one of those as well. Any questions on over here, Westminster?
Nope.
All right, the Reform Club is very similar to the Patent Office, except characters versus patents and prototypes. And the other big difference here is when you go there, obviously you're going to get a buzz if you were one of the first two to go there, but the other thing is you immediately must pay for that card. So now let me go ahead and bring your attention to the cards that are in this game. So we'll start with talking with the character cards. The name of the character is at the top. So here we have Lionel Rothschild and William Armstrong here, and a little number that corresponds to the card number there. The cost for acquiring that card is in gears and light bulbs or energy. Sometimes it may be money, it may be income, whatever is symbolized over here on the top left corner. When you acquire that card, you must immediately pay it for a character, okay? Then, depending on what year you actually acquired this card, so in the first two rounds, score that many points, the middle two rounds, or the final round, score that many points. Then, again, using the same symbology, the lightning bolt says, hey, you get an extra die. Well, the nice thing about that is I would now have my fifth die. However, I don't get to use it this round because we've already done that back in phase one, and we're now activating in phase three, so that'll be good for next round, okay? Here, I would go ahead and get number 26, which here, I will show you what that looks like. You'll notice that it says number 26. You flip it over. Oh, hey, look at that. It looks just like as shown there. So you get that, and that will be a phase six income bump on the income track. Easy enough. Then this shows whatever a bonus may happen during phase four. Once you have gotten your points, so in this case, if I were to somehow get both of these, paid for their cost, I will have scored, if this is in the first two rounds, a total of 8 points, and then whatever the immediate bonus is, and then I'm gonna flip them over to show that they have activated. There's flavor text over on this side, and we'll stagger them like so. On the back, it shows during phase four what it is, but it also shows any kind of upkeep hiring cost that it may have, which we'll cover that when we get to phase four. Any questions about the character cards?
No.
The patents work very similar with two significant differences. Number one is you don't pay this cost right now because you're going to do that potentially in phase five. And the other thing is their patents, when they're on this side, their prototypes when they're on this side. And the reason, the difference for that is there's going to be different bonuses that are associated with these as the game goes along, okay? So those are the two differences between the blue cards and the orange cards. Any questions on that? And we'll double back to both of these when we get into those phases there. All right, so assuming no questions, we now are through the fifth building. Moving on to the London Times. Going here, get one newspaper for the first one to activate. The last one to activate is pay £2. Then, what round is it? If we are in the first round, we are going to activate this column. Second round, third round, fourth round, fifth round. And what this is we're actually showing here what these things, depending on where you, how many of these you have, you're going to get that amount of buzz. Because it's a London Times, so it's advertising within the newspaper, right? And this says, how many patents do you have in your tableau? Patents, not prototypes. Patents, not prototypes, okay?
Great point.
All right. Depending on how many you have, you will get that much buzz. You will then advance that much. Let's say I have these two, I would advance four. One, two, three, four. All right, so now let's talk about the administrative track and the buzz track here on the administrative board. First off, when you reach or pass one of these little flyers, you immediately get whatever the bonus is. Okay, easy enough, hey, cool, I get one light bulb or one energy. Okay, done. However, any of these locations that have victory points or money or buzz on them, you'll notice that every player has two markers over here. These markers, when you pass that, you immediately have to decide, do you wish to place one of your markers on that spot permanently? Because during income, you then get whatever it is, be it 2 points, 5 points, 11 points, 7, 3, or two money or two buzz. If you say yes, then you place one of your markers out on that space. Easy enough. And then when we get to the income phase, I'm going to get my choice of that every round. If I say no, I can never choose to place one of my markers there again. You have two, and there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 locations. Choose wisely. That makes sense?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
All right. So going on here, these, we have character cards. These, we now notice, patents, prototypes. And this is how many research tiles, meaning these or the other purple tiles associated with those, and how far advanced on that track are you, get that associated buzz. Now, I also do want to point out, this is pretty nice, these are all modular and double-sided, and there's like five of these, yeah, four or five. There's a ton of those that vary it up. Some have to do with the black market, et cetera, et cetera. So any question about London Times? No, good, moving on. Port of London. Port of London is a little bit different. The Port of London and Waterloo Station work very similar to one another, so I'm going to kind of talk about these at the same time. Okay, the location 7 and location 8. Place your die just like normal, activate just like normal. However, all of these red locations that you see here are only one die per location. What does that mean? It means when I go onto this and then I activate and I choose to go ahead and do that, nobody else can do it. This is the only two places where you're going to move your dice twice when you activate. First one, there, okay, and then there, okay? And once I have chosen that, which in this case would be two gears, nobody else that chooses to activate here can do that action. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Same goes down here at Waterloo Station. So what are the available actions? Two administrative actions. However, the first one you don't have to pay for. So in other words, if it were like so, and I place up here, normally I would have to pay the £3. In that case, that's free. Then I can take a second administrative action, meaning I could either move up for free just like normal, or I would, if I place another one, I would have to pay to go onto that location. Does that make sense?
Yep.
All right. So that is there. And again, that could be those, or again, our third option is moving up the objective track. Two gears, get an extra die. Nice. Once you have six dice, okay, you're done with that. This one, get an extra die, but you got to pay $2. And finally, and this one's easy to forget, so don't overlook this one, these tickets. This is straight buying victory points. What this is if it's the first one, depending on what year it is, score 9, 6, or 3 points respectively, plus the pip value of the die. So if I were to do this in the first two phases, that would be worth 9 plus 4, that'd be 13 points. So we would take one of these tickets, we would cover that, and that die goes there. But it's there forever.
Forever.
So now, if you haven't acquired any more dice, you're down to 3 dice. But a max, now dice that you can have, is 5. Keep that in mind. Anybody playing Turkey, just Just pointing that out. Okay. There are three tickets. There are three spaces available. Once that's locked, obviously somebody has already claimed that. Easy enough. Any questions about Port of London? Good. Moving on to Waterloo Station. Works the exact same way. Get two energy. Get an energy or be able to get one of your income, whatever thing that is, a energy and two buzz. This one is get one of these income or two buzz. So there we go. That's all the locations available on the board. So once we have activated all eight buildings and done everything, then we go into phase four. Phase four says, well, you need to pay upkeep for all of your characters. Mm-hmm. So let's take a look here. Where is my marker? My marker is right here on the third step, kind of this beige looking step here. So we look at here, that would cost us $2 for Rothschild and $1 for Armstrong. So I would have to pay $3 out of my available money. Mm-hmm. But what happens if you don't have any money or you can't afford it? You cannot get rid of them.
Can't fire them.
It is a blood pact for life.
For life.
So what happens? Well, let me introduce you to the Martin Wallace aspect of the game. And we have loans. The loans, you take a loan, you get $10.
Nice.
Obviously pay whatever it is, okay? You can get loans at any point that you choose to do so. However, on one side, they show a -5 point. That's not the side that you should be concerned with. Let's flip that bad boy over. These range from 8, 9, and 10 points respectively. Because at the end of the game, you're going to have to pay back $10 to pay back that loan. When you pay back that loan, good news! You paid it back. Bad news! It's still going to cost you 5 points because you flip it over once you paid it back. So really, you covered up a -2 to a -5, so it only cost you 3 points, and maybe that $10 was really beneficial for when you needed it. However, if you don't pay it back at the end of the game, that's okay. It's okay. It's okay. But you now lose 9 points instead of 2 points. So it cost you 7 total. Does that make sense? A net of lost 7. But maybe you did have the money and you don't have to worry about it. Awesome. Good deal. Then you get to activate whatever the ability is on a banner on the fourth step. This says, based on how many of those I have, I get 1 point. Well, let's look. I currently have 2 of those. So I would get 2 points every income. If I get more of those, I would get more. Mm-hmm. Easy enough. Does that make sense? We would all do that simultaneously. Mm-hmm. All right, cool. Moving on to step 5. This happens in turn order, and this is important to go in turn order. Mm-hmm. This says in step 5, you may turn 2 patents into prototypes, a max of 2. You could, if you had 5, you can do 2. If you have 2, you can do 1 or 0 or 2, however you want to. Now is the time. You pay the cost in top left corner. You score whatever the points are. They work just like the cards here. And it shows when it goes from a patent to a prototype, you're going to get whatever this is. And it may have other abilities as shown here. At, again, immediate, or it might have an ongoing something or other. Now, I mentioned this is in turn order, and here is why. This beer glass counter, I could go ahead and get that marker to put onto my board over here. But maybe I just don't want that for whatever reason. I think that's crazy, but for whatever, maybe I don't have the $2 I would have to pay, and I don't want to have to take a loan. In that case, I can gift this to any player at the table in which they have to accept it. They don't actually get the card. They don't get the points. They get the bottom part of this. They have to activate the whole thing. So maybe Shrey only has $1. I say, Shrey, my friend, you get this. So we would find the number 12 of these, and he would actually take that tile. Congrats. And he would owe $2. Oh, he doesn't have $2? Here, my friend Shrey, go ahead, take a loan from the bank. You're welcome. But then once that's done, I will have scored, depending on what round it is, that many victory points, and then we'll flip that over. And then it may have some kind of recurring thing or not on it. That's what happens in step 5. Any questions on that?
Nope.
All right, easy enough. Moving on. And also, you'll notice that the right side of these, it's all flavor on that. So they did so that these can kind of stack up like so once they're flipped over. So remember, prototypes, not patents. Patent, not prototype. difference for symbology for some goals in the game. All right, moving on. Step six, hey, finally we get income.
Yay.
However, I want to point out this happens in a very specific order. The reason this matters is because you might get some things that are going to help you for this, but unfortunately this happens first. So this is, you get your income, and then due to upkeep costs, you're going to drop your income by 3. So looking at this, I would get £7, everybody else would get 4. Then after we have gotten our income, everybody is going to drop 3 steps. 1, 2, 3. Easy enough. Mm-hmm. However, if you end up in one of these locations, no harm, no foul. If you ever would drop past this, you're going to lose $1 when you would ping against that, okay? However, if you would get income and you start in that area, you're going to lose 1 point for doing so and get no income. Ouch. Don't let that be you, okay? All right, easy enough. That is getting income. Then you're going to activate all of your step six flags. So in this case, I would bump up 1, I would bump up 2 income because it has a flag. This was an immediate and that's just a loan. So I would get 2 income. So all right, 1, 2. Then we would look at the black market. I would get 1 gear and I would get $2 and I would get a bump on the newspaper track. And Derek would get 1 buzz, so we would move him up 1 on that, and Jess would get 1 energy. Okay, easy enough. Any questions on that?
No. Yeah.
All right. Then at the very bottom of this, you're going to get any bonuses that you have markers out on out here. So what does that mean? Well, if I had a marker, say here, and maybe Shrey has made it all the way up there, and he put a marker there, he put a marker there. Apparently he and I are the only ones playing this, but indulge me. We then would score whatever we get. So in this case, Shrey would get a total of 8 points. So we would peg 8 points on there, 5 and 3, and this would happen every round for him. And for me, I would either get 2 buzz, 1, 2, or 2 bucks, and maybe I decide to go ahead and put that there. And then, oh, hey, I would then score those 2 points. Easy enough?
Yep.
All right. Then step 7, reset. Administrators all drop 1 level and then a reset phase. So what does that mean? Everybody drops 1 spot. If you're at the bottom, you come back, go back into your supply. Everybody else just moves on down 1 space. Then we reset. What does a reset look like? All of the cards out here wipe. All of the cards out here wipe, put out new ones, and we'll put them into the bottom of the deck. We will wipe all of these, get new tiles there. Wipe these, get new tiles there. And then we would refill the gears here. We will advance the marker 1 round, and then we would begin anew, mm-hmm. round 1. Right. And that right there is how you play Crystal Palace. We go into endgame scoring, which I suppose is important and we probably ought to talk about real quick. So endgame scoring is very simple. Whatever points you have acquired throughout the game, then you have to, if you can, and you're going to want to, pay back your loans, $10 per loan on that. Then you're going to convert any energy and gears and newspapers, add them, they all convert to $1. Then you're going to turn in £10, and for every £10 left over, you're going to place it onto a free research. So in other words, if I had $10 left over after converting everything, I would then cover another one of those spaces like so, so I don't lose those 2 points. Then we're going to minus 2 point for every space that is on our board here. Then whoever has leading or made it up here first, which I've yet to see, but whoever's leading on the buzz track, first, second, third, scores 6, 4, and 2 respectively. The highest administrator on this would get 3, 2, and 1 respectively. And finally, add up your, or not add up, but the highest objective level that you have attained. Whoever has the most points wins. And if tied, you share in a tie because it's the World's Fair. Congratulations. And that there is how you play Crystal Palace. Any questions?
There were 3 things. First, okay. Someone asked when this is coming out. I think
according to Clay, his goal, and Clay is supposed to be here. So
he was in. He said
okay.
Hi. Yeah.
Okay. According to Clay, he said he's hoping
December
to have this in time for Thanksgiving, or ahead of, ahead of Thanksgiving, call it. That's his goal.
Wow.
But, you know, Yeah, it happens. At the front so that's line question booth, one. What else?
Yeah, the people were also asking about the different boards, and it was pointed out in the chat that they're different just for different player accounts. So it's just worth reiterating that there's a whole bunch of boards for different players.
Yeah, so, okay, the British Museum. So two-player looks like this, okay? Yeah. Three-player looks like this, mm-hmm. and you're going to have to take my word for it that the five-player actually adds spaces so you can get an idea. Westminster, that's going to be the three-player board, the two-player board, et cetera, et cetera. Okay?
And some of these are for multiple players. So this is a 4-5.
Correct.
So it's, you know, there is making a board entirely for four players, a single piece
so
of
So as you can see, these both are at 4 and 5 players, respectively. Yeah.
And then the other question that someone was asking about the bumping up on this track.
Yes.
Based on what they were reading in the rules, they thought that you are supposed to pay. So it's worth double checking.
Okay, we'll double check that, and that's that. Derek, if you would be so kind as to shuffle those in. Jess, if you would shuffle those in, I will take
you
my
check
workers.
That. I'll take care of this.
Okay. All right. She's going to reset my board. And you know what? I will double check that. And then I will bring the chat up and we'll get ready to rock and roll, y'all. All right. So the black market actions. Let me double check.
Oh, I can.
That's over actually here. Over here.
It goes in order.
This one goes here. So separate those.
Yeah. These are in order.
Oh, he's got them. Okay.
With the characters.
Yeah, these are the characters.
Check that. You do pay if you move up.
Okay,
confirmed.
Thank
so
you.
let me fix the one thing that I did misspeak on. So when you place an administrator, you must place in the lowest available space and pay that amount. If you bump up, you do pay that amount that you bump up to as well. All right, cool.
Seemed really
got
good,
that got that cleared up. Thank you for the correction. Anything else?
Nope. I think we're good.
All right,
and we can explain synergy of characters.
Oh shoot, that's the other thing. Thank you. So you'll notice that some of these have little banners on them, and they correspond, and it actually shows. Like for instance, Buckland here says the portable decoder. When the portable decoder comes out, if it comes out, if you actually activate into a prototype and you have that, you're going to score a bonus 4 points when that happens. When either you get the character and it flips over. Or you have that and you flip over a patent into a prototype, you score the 4 points. Whenever there's a synergy or a link, it's called between them. Okay.
The pocket watch is the only other thing that we have a component
Thank
for.
Thank you. But. Yeah, the pocket watch. I will actually bring that over here. So pocket watch. When you get that, this shows you will immediately score 3 points, or you will have an income of $3 cash. However, it's important to note. There are somewhere in the neighborhood of 4 to 6 cards between the two decks that show the pocket watch. Meaning, if you choose this, that's fine. But if somebody else takes it from you, well, you've now lost that. If you take it a second time, you then could keep it here, or you could choose to flip it over to the other side. Or if you've activated this, you then could activate it again when you got the pocket watch the second time. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
All right, cool. Good catch. All right, we're just going to put that up here as a kind of resource.